Okay, so welcome all of you, and let's start our now this paper, that is the Cochin Shipyard Limited paper, that is 40 questions. Before I go for that, let me tell you this exam tentative date of Cochin Shipyard Limited exam is second week of December. So some students dropped the mail to CSL people and they said this information, they provided this information that second week of December mein there can be exam of Cochin Shipyard CSL. So gear up, just be prepared for this exam, and you should you know, now you will get only 15-20 days if exam is declared. So just prepare very well, so that if 15-20 days are given to you, you are in position to revise everything and go to the examination hall with full preparation. So the kind of questions which mentors are doing in Yourpedia, that is exactly same as what we can expect in this particular exam, that is Cochin Shipyard. So many practice questions are being provided to you on regular basis. So just revise, keep you know, the preparation schedule as per the mentors, and prepare well. So this is my third video, this is third lecture actually for CSL. First two are already there on YouTube, you can check it out. One was easy degree of difficulty, then moderate degree of difficulty, and now this is a little more degree of difficulty level. And you know, I believe that this is the level which normally paper comes, not beyond this. They will not ask you beyond that. And this is 1 minute, one question. So you understand what kind of depth will be there. And there's non-technical part also. So prepare well. Today I'm going to do 40 questions. What you have to do is, you are not to write in your copy. You are not to do that. Just to solve it. This document, entire document, questions and solution, you will get on the website. In the description, you will get the link. And once you go to the, you know, website, you will get this document. So you can download this document. And others also, full length test, whatever I will cover. 40 questions each till our exam. I will cover more tests. So you will get the full description there. You can download that for CSL. So should we start now? Let me give you first question and check your level. My expectation from you is you should get, you know, somewhere around, you know, 30 out of 40 questions correct. Not guesswork. I'm not talking about the guesswork. You should basically get 30 out of 40 questions. Check on your own whether you get it or not. And when I do the question, maybe we get some information also, and related questions also, you should do it. Let's go for first question. And here comes my first question for you. This is a question. Which of the following is used to support the core in casting? So he will give you some names and ask you which one is used. So one, chill, then chaplet, then print, and then sprue. So these are the four names. I'm very sure you people can hit it. Those of you who know, they can hit it. Yes. So some of you have given the answer before even choices. So the answer is chaplet. Chaplet and chills, these are two very, very important things. So yeah, let me give you a small diagram here. I'll give you a diagram here. Just see, this diagram is already there. So you need not to make this diagram. This diagram is already there in the, you know, this notes which I'm going to provide you. So, but you understand this diagram through this question. I want you to understand more. So let me give you this diagram here. Okay. Okay, so try to see this diagram carefully. In the casting, you will understand some names here. In the casting, this is the casting. I'm going to give you sand casting. And in this casting, there are some names which you should know. Okay, this is the sand casting. and then with the red color I'm making something which is called chaplet. Okay, so now let me give you the names here. What are the names of certain things? This particular thing is called chaplet. Chaplet is something which supports the core. Core is something which is used to produce the hollow section. It is used to produce the hollow section. Now, this particular thing is called casting. This particular thing is called casting. This part is called cope. This part is called drag. This is pouring basin. This one is pouring basin. And this is how the, you know, the flask, the molding flask has two compart. Upper part is called cope, and then there's a drag part, and then there's a core. Core is supported by a device which is called a chaplet. And chaplet is made up of same metal. It is made up of same metal as that of the component. So casting material and, you know, this core print is different. Don't think of core print. Core print is different thing. That is basically used to put the core inside the cavity. But, you know, the metallic device which is used to support the basically core inside is called chaplet. Print is also used to support the core, no doubt about that. That is also used, but that is a special kind of support. If out of these two one is asked, then that is a chaplet, and chaplet is a metallic device. So if in the question is saying which of the following metallic device, if that is a question, then core, then only chaplet answer will come, print will not come. And the real name is not print, it is a core print. So answer choices mein core print was not given, print was given, which is wrong answer. Actually, there is nothing like print, it is a core print. So you can say this chaplet is to be there. Now, very similar to chaplet, there is a term called chill. Now, chill is used for directional solidification. Remember these two things. Chill is made up of same metal as that of the casting. Chaplet is made up of the same metal as that of the casting. The moment you pour the molten metal, chill and chaplet both get melt, and you know they get dissolved in the molten metal. And the purpose of both is different. It is used to support the core, which is used to create the hollow section, and chill is used to give directional solidification, uniform solidification, so that errors are not come. Let me ask you a question. Out of chaplet and chill, which one do you think will prevent the casting defect? Out of chaplet and chill, which one do you think will prevent the casting defect? Chill or chaplet? What is the answer? Casting defect, which one will prevent? No, answer is both chaplet and chill. Because when you go for the casting defects, if the core is displaced from its position, even then that leads to a casting defect. And if directional solidification is not appropriate, even then there's a casting defect. So if the exam question is come, which of these two is used to prevent the casting defect, chaplet or chill? Answer is both. Chaplet and chill are used to prevent. Why? Because if they are not being used, some casting defect is going to come. Anyhow, let's go for next question. So just keep checking how many of total question you are hitting correct. Okay, find the odd one out. Find the odd one out. I'm giving the four choice. Ingot, then I'm giving you slab, then I'm giving you billet, then I'm giving you bloom. Okay, you have to find the odd one out. Looks like little ticklish. Find the odd one out. Find the odd one out. Which one is odd one out? Ingot, slab, billet, or bloom? These four names you please remember. These are the, you know, products of casting. I mean, casting ka jo product nikal ke aata hai, whatever product comes out from the casting, that is called, these are the names for that. Which one is the odd one out? Yes, any idea? Answer is billet. Hit the billet, I tell you why. Billet has square cross section. It has square cross section. All other have rectangular cross section or something like that. Now let me give you the idea. Billet has square cross section. Let me tell you what is now diagram. Let me give you for I start with first, that is in God. So you can understand, as I told you, this all thing I'm going to give you in the notes. So description mein you will get a link. There's a link in the description. You go to the website and you download this. All notes I have kept there, so you can take it. Just focus on understanding. So first is in God. Try to understand what is in God. In God is nothing but a brick. It is like a brick. You must have seen the brick. So this is the first product which comes from the casting, from the foundry, from the sand. What you take out is the in God. That's the first thing, right? And then what you do, then you process it further, and then you get a slab. Then you get sort of slab. So slab and billet, what is the difference? Dimensions. Dimensions keep on changing. It is looking like a brick. And then slab is something, you know, it is not as thick as brick, but it extends. You go further working on this, and this is called slab. Normally, the width of slab is double the thickness of the slab, double the thickness. So when you double the thickness from the width, so this is the thickness, you know, and this is the width. So the slab is width is more than double the thickness. That is the meaning of it. But you cannot say like this in the bricks. You cannot say that width is double the thickness. You cannot say that. In God gives you then slab. And further, when you work on slab, you get the sheets. You know what is the meaning of sheets now? The dimension further changes. So then you get the sheets. So remember, in God is the first product which you get. It gives you slab, it gives you sheet. So these are the three things which we understood now. As a casting, as a manufacturing engineer, you should know that what is the meaning of it. Now I come to billet. You know, this is billet. This is billet. That was our question, right? So that brick which is having cross-section area as a square is called billet. So what is the difference between billet and ingot? Sir, ingot is looking like rectangular cross-section, whereas billet is a square cross-section. Billet is square cross-section. Slab is also, you know, rectangular cross-section. And this is how, and even bloom. So they are square, they are rectangular cross-section. Now from billet, I get two kind of things. From billet, I get two kind of things, products. I get two kind of products from the billet. One is rod. You must have seen trucks carrying this product. So that is basically the rod. Sorry, that is called the bar. And if it is square cross section, that is called rod. So can you tell me what is now bar and what is rod? So from billet, you get these two products. Bar is also having square cross section, but length is very large. And then rod is circular cross section. So billet gives you these two things. So the question here was basically odd one out. Find the odd one out. And billet is very, very important because square cross section. And in God is something which you get initially. Initially got. In God, initially got. You know, there are mnemonics. We used to use these mnemonics to memorize the things. Initially, what you got in casting? Sir, in God. Initially, you got. I hope you understand what I mean to say. Initially, you got. In God. That is how you are to memorize the things. So initially you got this, and then further you made other things from this. Okay, that was question number two. Now let me take you to question number three. As I told you, you are not to write anything. You have to read the question and try to solve the question. Notes you are going to get as you go on the site. So let me take you to third question here. Let me take you to third question. Okay, this is which of the following materials require largest shrinkage allowance while making the pattern for casting. While making the pattern for casting, as I told you, out of 40 question, you are to hit 30 correct. I'm giving you aluminium. Second is brass. Third is cast iron, and fourth is steel. So try to understand the question. You have pattern of four different materials. These are four different materials, and I have made a pattern of these four. And you have to tell that which material will give you maximum shrinkage allowance. So that means pattern, as you know, the size of the pattern is more than actually the size which you want, because you have to basically get that particular mold cavity also. Some allowances are given. So which one is the answer for that? Shrinkage allowance. Which shrinkage allowance do you get is more? Okay. Shrinkage allowance. Let me tell you pattern material. So answer for that, just hit the answer. What answer would you like to give? As this this entire session is for, you know, checking where you hit out of 40, how many questions do you correct. So okay, so some of you are saying aluminium, some of you saying brass and steel or something like that. Just keep in your copy and answer is steel. Now material and allowances, material and pattern allowance. Let me give you that pattern allowance. So let me give you some data here. That is cast iron allowance is in millimeter per meter. That is how allowance is calculated. How much millimeter per meter? So for cast iron it is 7 to 10. When I come to steel, it is 20. If aluminium, almost close, 18. Brass is 14. But when I talk about white cast iron, it is the maximum, that is 21. White cast iron is 21. Remember that. So this is more or less, you know, data oriented question. This is more or less data oriented question. So that depends on the material property only. So from the manufacturing or production, he might ask data oriented question from you. So sometime he will ask you data oriented question. So which material has maximum pattern allowance? That is white cast iron. And steel also has huge pattern allowance. So that is 20, more than this. So that was the question. Let me take you to next question. Looks like not very difficult. Let's see whether you answer it. Voltage requirement for resistance welding, voltage requirement for resistance welding is typically, so what is the voltage requirement typically? 100 volt, 20 volt, 1 volt and 150 volt. So what is the typically voltage requirement for resistance welding? You know energy flow in the resistance welding, you are all aware. So all of you are watching the, you know, dedicated full length paper that is for Cochin Shipyard Limited. We are doing 40 question, you have to hit 30 correct. We are hitting at fourth question. Okay, I give you 30 more seconds to think. Which one do you think is the voltage for this resistance welding? You have resistance welding and you have to hit what is the voltage requirement for that. So remember that one question normally is asked for different welding processes, what is the voltage current requirement. Now let me tell you what is the resistance welding. Heat energy released is V into I square into R into T. I is the current flow, R is the resistance, and T is the time for which the current will flow. Now you know resistance welding may, if you want to melt the material, the energy or heat produced will be from this formula. So that means I should be very large and it is in lakhs of ampere. Yes, you heard correctly, it is in lakhs of ampere. So current has to be very, very high. Current has to be very high. Whereas voltage, I don't want voltage. Why? Because high voltage is required when electron is to jump, something like arc voltage, open circuit voltage, 80 volt or something. Whenever you do numericals, keep one thing in mind. The data which is given in numericals is important for these kind of exams. Like you have done a lot of numericals in fluid mechanics, where you know what is the surface tension of water. But if I ask you what is the surface tension of water, right now you will not be remembering what is the surface tension of water. So my advice to you is, whenever you do numerical in which modulus of elasticity comes, yield strength comes, surface tension comes, just memorize those data, because that it comes in the exam. So now voltage in arc welding, remember what was the voltage in arc welding? Sir, 40 volt, 30 volt, open circuit volt, short circuit current, you have done that, right? Now for resistance welding, I do not need much voltage. So 1 volt is okay for me, and that is typically this. And what about this? Sir, this looks like arc welding may running voltage. And what about this? Sir, this looks like open circuit voltage in arc welding. Open circuit voltage when there is no current flowing, right? So remember that this is the way. Yes. So I think Muhammad has given me the value of surface tension of the water. Thanks a lot. So this is how you need to go for it. Okay. So next question, like this is the fourth question. Now let me take you to the next question. That is the fifth question. Okay. So I'm giving you fifth question. Now try to hit this question. In arc welding, 25 volt and 300 ampere are provided. So these are the voltage current characteristic. So in arc voltage, in the arc welding, I'm using 25 volt and 300 ampere. Arc heat transfer efficiency is 85%. So heat transfer efficiency of the arc welding is given as 85%. If the welding speed is 8 millimeter per second, find the net heat input in joule per millimeter. Answer choices given are 796.8, then it is 684.2, then it is 620.7, and then it is 721.6 joule per millimeter. So read the question carefully. He has given you arc welding process, and typically arc welding process, what is the current? 300 ampere. What is the voltage? 25 volt. Arc heat transfer efficiency is 85% when you try to transfer the heat, not entire heat goes to the welding. There are some losses. So 85% goes there. Welding speed is 8 millimeter per second. Now you have to tell me what is actually the heat input in joule per millimeter. This question, let me give you a hint, is to be solved from dimensional units. So check the units, and if you analyze the units, use the brain, common sense, then you can solve this question. I give you 30 seconds, hit the answer. Find out what is the answer for this. And you are solving Cochin Shipyard paper, 40 question, entire syllabus. You are to hit 30 correct. And then you can say, okay, I have a preparation level. So tell me what is the answer for that. Okay, that's it. This is the time you are going to get. Theoretical heat. How much heat energy you are getting? You know, heat or power, to be more specific. Can anybody tell me what is voltage into current? That is power, joule per second. Voltage into current, voltage in volt, current in ampere gives you joule per second. That is the power. Now, can anybody tell me joule per second to joule per millimeter? What should I do? Yes, joule per second over millimeter per second will give me joule per millimeter. That means if I multiply VI and divide that with speed, I'm going to get joule per millimeter. But you know what? You need to also multiply with efficiency. So theoretically, so what is the theoretical heat input? Theoretical heat supply. What is theoretically I'm supplying from machine is VI joule per second, right? VI joule per second. Same thing, if I divide with speed, then I get this much joule per millimeter as the heat which I am supplying, right or not? Now, actual may, if I am to supply, this will be VI over speed into efficiency. Now multiply 25 into 300, and then it is 8, and then 0.85. If you multiply it, I believe you get 796.8 joule per millimeter. So as I told you, you are to use the common sense, you are to use the dimension for this to solve these questions. Very simple questions, and they can be asked in exam from you. So just understand the concept. We are sitting here to solve questions and see where our level is. Solution and answers and questions I have already provided you. Let's go for next question now. And I hit question number 6. Question number 6 is this. Orthogonal cutting is given. Orthogonal cutting data is provided to us. What is the data given? Chip thickness ratio. Chip thickness ratio is given as 0.4. Rake angle is 20 degree. Rake angle given is 20 degree. Find the shear plane angle. Find the shear plane angle. Some data he gives you, cos 20 degree. He gives you 0.94. Sin 20 degree he gives as 0.34. So this is the data he provides you, and the answer choices given are cos inverse 0.711, then tan inverse 0.435, then tan inverse 0.711, and then tan inverse 0.211. So orthogonal cutting is given to us, chip thickness ratio is 0.4, and then rake angle is given as 20 degree, shear plane angle you have to find out. These are the answer choices. Hit A, B, C, D. What is answer for you? And write in your copy what answer you are giving. You have to hit 30 out of 40. Try each one of you. Everyone should try to solve this question. I give 30 seconds, then I go forward. Okay, so I think many of you have got it. Chip thickness ratio formula is sin phi divided by cos of phi minus alpha. Let me tell you the angles. Sin phi, cos phi, cos alpha, plus sin phi, sin alpha. Now what is phi? Phi is, alpha is the rake angle. Alpha is 20 degree. And phi is the angle which I want to find out. Phi is shear angle which I want to find out. Chip thickness ratio is given as 0.4. Now sine phi over this. So what we know is cos alpha is already given to us. So this angle is alpha, that is 20 degree. Cos alpha, you will put here 0.94, you will put here 0.34. So what we get is 0.4 is equal to sin phi divided by 0.94 cos phi plus 0.34 sin phi. Now if you take this entire this side and divide throughout with sin phi, you get tangent 5. B is the answer. Solving will be simple, not difficult. So answer for this will be B. Yes, good. Some of you have already done it. Now, this was the formula for this. Let me take you to the next question now. Question number 7. This is the question number 7. Ratio of forward to return stroke. Forward to return stroke. Return stroke. In shaper is, so what is the ratio? Choices given are 2:1, then 3:1, then 3:2, then 4:3. So what is the ratio of, you know, forward to return stroke in the shaper? You know, return stroke of the shaper and forward stroke of the shaper. Return is should be basically this is the idle stroke. This is idle stroke and should take less time. Should take less time. That is the reason forward it will go slow and come back fast. But what is that ratio? What is the ratio of going far forward and coming backward? At what speed it goes forward? So I will say ratio of forward time taken. Time taken in forward stroke, in cutting stroke. Forward stroke is cutting stroke. And time taken in return stroke. Time taken in return stroke. So actually, when it is going forward cutting, it should take more time. And when it is coming back, it is idle stroke, it should come fast. But you know, all the choices are that way only. All the choices are more than one. Now, which one we need to hit? There is no logic. There is no common sense. This is answer. 3:2. This answer, no common sense. But asked many exams. This particular question is asked in many exams. Especially Southern Indian exams like Tamil Nadu Public Service Commission questions paper or something like that. We have seen some papers in the public sectors. So they have asked this question many times. Okay. So that was the question. Now let's go to question number 8. I hit question number 8 now. Feed F for lathe operation. For lathe operation. You know what is lathe machine. So what is the value of feed for lathe operation? I give you answer choices. N over LT millimeter per revolution. Now let me explain you the terms also here. But first write the choice L over NT, then T over NL, then it is, you know, TL over N. The units are same. Now what is T? T is the machining time. T is the machining time in minute. Machining time in minute. Then N is RPM. Speed in RPM and L is length of cut in millimeter. Length of cut in millimeter. So even by dimensionally you can solve this question. I will tell you that think of dimension. See, out of 40 question, believe me, out of 40 question, 3-4 question you can try to solve through dimensional analysis, units and elimination. 3-4 question you can do that for sure. Why? Because now this question also, feed is millimeter per revolution. You want to get millimeter per revolution, right? So obviously dimensionally you can solve it. Let me tell you, the time of machining formula is L over Fn. This is the formula. So that you need to remember. Time is L. L is the length. Then, you know, this F is basically millimeter per revolution. And this is RPM. So if you see, this is meter or millimeter, let us say this is millimeter per revolution and this one is revolution per minute. So revolution gets cancelled out here, millimeter gets cancelled out here, T goes, minute goes at the top. I will say purely dimensional question. This was purely dimensional question. So if you solve this question, the answer for that is L over NT. So question looks like difficult, but actually it is not. Dimensionally only you have to solve this question. Some questions are to be solved dimensionally. Let me ask you next question now. Question number 9. Maximum reduction that can be obtained. Maximum reduction that can be obtained in any material. In any material during wire drawing, maximum reduction that can be done. assume the conditions to be ideal conditions with all the assumptions together. So what can be maximum reduction? 43%, 53%, 63%, 73%. Okay, hit it. What is the answer for this? 63%, 43%, 53%, or what? So what is the answer for this? What can be the maximum reduction which we can get in any material during wire drawing? Okay, now what is the answer for this? Let me tell you, there is a formula. Stress induced during wire drawing is log of A naught by A final. This is a formula you need to revise. Wire drawing, if you go, the stress induced during drawing is equal to yield strength of the material. This is the yield strength of the material. Yielding means when, you know, when yielding starts, you cannot reduce it beyond that. You know, when yielding starts, you can say, okay, now plastic deformation has started. So yield limit pay, your maximum value sigma D will be less than equal to sigma y. So let's take the limiting case. Sigma d is equal to sigma y. So log of a naught by a f, this becomes equal to 1. A naught by a f becomes equal to e. Log goes that side, it becomes e. And what is the value of e? 2.718. And what is the question is asked you? What is the percentage maximum reduction in area or something we are asking? So what is the reduction? Original area minus final area over original area into 100. That is the question he is asked. What is the percentage reduction in area? Original area A naught, final area is AF over original area. So A naught by AF we have already got, and this is what we want to get. Right? So if you put that thing in value, this is 1 minus AF over A naught, or you can take otherwise also. So what you get answer is 63.2%. So that was the question for this. Done. Let's go to question number 10. I reach question number 10 and we are solving the Cochin Shipyard 40 questions. Entire syllabus, you have to hit 30 out of 40. And if you hit 30 out of 50, 40, you are doing good job. And these 40 questions which I have taken, they're actually on the basis of what question I think can come, right? So now, abrasive jet machining. Abrasive jet machining. In abrasive jet machining, the distance between nozzle tip and work surface. Distance between nozzle tip and work surface, nozzle tip and work surface increases, then material removal rate. So the question is, as you increase the distance between the nozzle tip and work surface in abrasive jet machining, what happens to material removal rate? Choice A, continuously increases. Choice B, continuously decreases. Choice C, increases then decreases. Choice D, decreases then increases. What is the answer? So abrasive jet machining, nozzle tip and workpiece difference. What happens to material removal rate as you change this distance between the two? Okay, what happens to this? Since you have, you know, I'll give you a couple of seconds to think. Tell what happens to this. Okay, now this is the diagram which we get. This is the material removal rate. This is the material removal rate. And this is the nozzle tip distance. Nozzle tip distance. As the nozzle tip distance increases, the material removal rate first increases and then hit the plateau and then decreases. So C is the correct answer for that. And there are reasons for that. As you increases the nozzle tip distance, in the beginning Why material removal rate increases? Because as the abrasive comes out from the nozzle tip, it gets some kind of space for acceleration. So that abrasive, when it comes from here, this is the workpiece, let us say. So as you increase this distance y, when the y is zero, material removal rate will be very less, almost zero. As you increase y, then the abrasive accelerates and impinges the workpiece with speed. It increases the material removal rate. But as you increase the y further, what happens is, now air drag also play a role, and that air drag basically reduces the energy in the abrasives, and then material removal rate decreases. So that reasons are there, obviously, but we are not discussing the reasons. So here, that is the answer for this. 11th question, in the G codes, in G codes of NC programming, numerically controlled machines, NC part programming, when you do NC part programming, G21 represents what? What is the G and M code? Numerically controlled machines, you have G codes, you have M codes. What is G21 representing? Let me give you the answer choices. Input values specified in millimeter. Second choice is return to reference point. So return to reference point. C is thread cutting in turning. Thread cutting in turning. And then dwell for a specified time. So these are the four choices. Now hit the right choice. What is G21 in G codes of NC part programming? Numerically controlled part programming. If you are targeting to join industry, production industry, manufacturing industry, do not forget about G and M codes. They are very, very important codes. You need to do that. Okay, what is G21 giving you? Any guess? What is G is going to give you? Yes. So G is going to give you input values which are specified in millimeter. Yes. Now there is nothing, no understanding behind this. But what I advise is G and M codes, please go through that. In numerically controlled part programming is important topic in manufacturing. You must go for that. Okay, let me go for question number 12 now. I go for question number 12. Which of the following is not a robot programming method? Which of the following is not a robot programming method? Manual programming method. A is manual programming method. So he has given you some names. Second is walkthrough programming method. C is teach pendant method. Numerical programming method. Yes, so put your guess. Tell me, what is your guess for this? Which of the following is not a robot programming method? Which one of the following is not a robot programming method? What do you think? Use the elimination process. Okay. So numerical programming method is not actually used in robot for programming the robot. it is not used. When you do numerical programming method, you will see that, okay, these are the methods which are not used in that particular. It is used for machining, not for robot. Robot means there is a different kind of maneuvering. So elimination ke base pe, you are to go for this. You are to use the elimination method and then forward, you have to proceed in that. Let's go for next question. That is question number 13. When magnetic field, please write, when magnetic field is removed, when magnetic field is removed, if I remove the magnetic field, which type of material maintains magnetic property. So he will give you some materials: ferromagnetic, paramagnetic, diamagnetic, and then is piezomagnetic. And read the question carefully. When you remove the magnetic field, which of these will still retain the magnetic properties? Which of these still retain the magnetic property? Hit the answer. What do you think is the answer for this? Hit the answer. Okay. Which of the following will retain? You know, answer for this is ferromagnetic material. Ferromagnetic material have large positive susceptibility. This is the term. Susceptibility. Magnetic susceptibility. There is a magnetic susceptibility which is positive. And you know, if you keep them in the magnetic field, they get highly magnetized. When you remove it, they remain there, polarized, molecules remain polarized, which provide them positive susceptibility, and they remain magnetic only. They exhibit very strong, a strong attraction in the magnetic field. They get magnetized in the magnetic field strongly. Examples for that is iron, cobalt, and nickel. Iron, cobalt, and nickel are highly magnetized materials, so they are ferromagnetic. Okay, let me go for next question, and that brings me to question number 14. Let me go for question number 14. Babbitt material are used for. Babbitt materials are used for choice A, gears, choice B, bolt, choice C, bearings, and choice D, clutches. Okay, Babbitt material. Why do you use the Babbitt material? What is the application of Babbitt material? Okay, what is the application of Babbitt material? So some of the alloying materials are very, very important, and you should revise that before you go to the exam, because you know, manufacturing companies, they deal a lot with these kind of materials. So answer, yes, the right answer for that is bearing. This is called bearing material. You know, it has a tin. Majority it has tin, and then you know, antimony, carbon, antimony, there is a copper. So basically this is an alloy of tin and lead based material. You know, tin and lead, this is the alloy of this. This is called bearing material. Also it is called white element. This is also called white element. This is a material, and it has a very good heat resistivity. That is the reason it is used in bearings. Heat resistance is very good, and durability is very good. So durability is the thing for which I will choose this material, and this is called a white metal also, white element also, and it has lead and tin based alloying element, and asked in many exams, it is asked in that particular question. Next question looks like simple question only for you. So let me create some space here. Okay, so let me go for this. Question number 15 now. Let me go for question number 15. And this is a question, corrosion resistance of stainless steel, corrosion resistance of stainless steel is due to choice A chromium, choice B tungsten, vanadium, and choice D is copper. Very simple question, it is not a difficult question. So stainless steel, the corrosion resistance of stainless steel is because of what? Which alloying element? That is a question. So corrosion resistance of stainless steel is because of which of the elements? You know, this chromium is the main element for which stainless, it does not produce stain, no stain, no corrosion. So that is the reason this steel is called stainless steel, and chromium is responsible for that. So what does chromium do? Chromium makes oxide. So chromium in contact with oxide will become chromium oxide, and this chromium oxide is a relatively strong layer, and it does not let the atmospheric oxygen to oxidize the material. What is corrosion? Corrosion is a chemical process, you know, that is a chemical process in which oxygen of the atmosphere will basically oxidize the material and spoil it. So chromium oxide will not let the atmospheric oxygen oxidize the material by forming the chromium oxide. It is a barrier actually for further oxidation, and no stains are produced. Now there are three main categories of stainless steel. Austenite, one is called austenite. You need not to write these things because I am giving you this material which I prepared. So all these questions are available on the link which will be attached to description. You can go there, and on the website this material is there. Ferrite stainless steel, and third is martensite stainless steel. So these are the three categories of stainless steel. So what happens in stainless steel? There is no stain. That means there is no corrosion, no oxidation. So what prevents oxidation? Chromium oxide layer will not let further oxidation. I tell you, in manufacturing, aluminum oxide and chromium oxide, these two are very important oxide layers. Aluminum oxide will not let further welding to take place. And there is a reason aluminum welding is very difficult. So when you want to do aluminum welding, don't let it oxidize. Because if aluminum gets oxidized, then you know what? Aluminum oxide will be formed. And its melting point is far more than, you know, the basic metal. Aluminum ka melting point is very less, 600 degrees centigrade. Aluminum oxide is very high. If I'm not wrong, 1900 degrees centigrade. Similarly, chromium oxide will not let, actually, chromium oxide is good thing. Aluminum oxide is bad thing. Chromium ki all the properties are related to, chromium all properties are related to its oxide, and aluminum ki properties oxides, we don't want that. So this is how we need to understand. Anyhow, so this was the question related to this. Now I come to question number 16. So let's go for question number 16. Super saturated, this question also is asked in many exams. Interstitial solid solution of carbon in alpha iron is known as choices given are martensite, then it is perlite, and then it is bainite, then it is ferrite. Yes, I am sure you will hit it correctly. Yeah. So super saturated interstitial solid solution of carbon in alpha iron is known as what? Martensite, perlite, bainite, ferrite, what do you call it? What do you think is the answer? And give me the answer. This is a very frequently asked question in the exams. And still not, your exam has not been declared of, you know, Cochin Shipyard. So the moment exam is declared, we will increase the frequency of this paper so that you can, you know, prepare on your own. You can get to know, okay, and who knows what question can come in exam. So most important questions, I come out here with full 40 questions, most important questions, and we can make a concepts, right? So answer for that is martensite. What is martensite? I want you to remember that martensite is BCT. Remember these words, martensite is BCT. You know what is BCT? BCT is body centered tetragonal. Body centered tetragonal. This is very important. Body centered tetragonal. So the shape, if he asks you, what is the, you know, martensite is a very, very hard material, right? It is produced, it is the product, it is produced through a normalizing process, heat treatment process, quenching process. When the cooling rate is very fast, which you get in normalizing, then the process normalizing gives you martensite because of the very fast cooling rate. And what formation you get is BCT, body centered tetragonal. Now, because it is so hard, it is useless. So to reduce or remove the hardness or reduce the hardness, we go for tempering process. Normalizing gave you martensite. Once you get martensite, temper it. Once you temper it, you get something which is useful material, right? Like bainite or something like that. So this is body center tetragonal. And this is basically, it is the super saturated solution of carbon and BCT and BCT ferrite, that is alpha iron. BCT is a modified BCC basically. It is nothing but modified BCC, body centered cubic. So BCT is the shape of this basically martensite. Okay, let me go for next question and we hit question number 17 now. This is the question number 17. Industry produces 300 spark plugs in a shift of 8 hours. So in the shift of 8 hours, these are the plugs produced. The standard time of production, of one piece of plug, spark plug, is 1.5 minute. Productivity is, what is productivity? Answer choices is 3/4, then 5/8, then 7/16, then 15/16. What do you know by productivity? So what do you understand by productivity? Why a standard time of production is given? 300 spark plugs are produced in 8 hours. Standard time of 300 spark, these are the actual production, you know. This is the actual production in 8 hours. I'm producing 300 plugs. But standard time is, that is, I'm capable to produce 1.5 minute, one plug I can make in 1.5. How do you define the productivity? Let me tell you what is productivity. Productivity is nothing but output, actual output, standard output. Actual output, how much you are getting? We are getting 300 plugs per 8 hours. So actual output is how much? Actual output, which my industry is 300 divided by 8 per hour. Understand that? So it comes out to be 150/4, 75/2, something like this. So these many plugs per hour. But how much I can produce? What is the standard output? What is the standard output per hour? So per piece is taking 1.5 minute. So how many in 1 minute, you know, so how many I can produce in 60? So, you know, I can produce 60/1.5 per hour, right? In 1.5 minute, I'm producing one plug, right? So 60 minutes, how much I'm producing? In 1.5 minute, if I'm producing one plug, in 1 hour, how many can I produce? 60/1.5. So if you take the ratio of these two, that means 75/2/60/1.5, what you get is the answer. I think 15/16. That is the productivity. So how much you are actually producing and how much is the standard you have is defining the productivity. That is how productivity is defined. So in the exam, question from standard time and productivity question from comes in the exam from there also. So remember this concept. If you have not done this concept, revise it. That is what I'm telling you. Solving more and more question, making more and more concept clear. That is all about the exam. Let's go for next question. Question number 18. Keep checking your level. I'm giving you question number 18. Depreciation can be calculated. Can be calculated by. He giving some method. Choice A. Time series method. Time series method. Choice B. ABC analysis. Choice C. Pareto analysis. Pareto analysis. And then D is diminishing balance method. Diminishing balance method. Diminishing balance method. Okay. You know what is depreciation? The reduction in the value of certain things with passage of time. Whether it is, your tangible thing or intangible thing. So when reduction in the value of something comes, it is called depreciation. How do you calculate depreciation? Which method do you use to calculate depreciation? So which method do you use to calculate depreciation? Yes. So answer is diminishing balance method. Let me tell you some of the methods to calculate the depreciation. Just remember, depreciation is a reduction in the value of something with passage of time. Why do you calculate depreciation? That helps you in basically saving the tax, not selling the product, saving the tax. Let me give you an example. Suppose I say the car which I have, I purchased it in 5 lakh rupees. And after 1 year, its cost depreciated to 4 lakh. Now I'm to pay insurance. You know the insurance is paid on the actual price. Actual price 5 lakh, I paid insurance more. Actual price 4 lakh, I'm to pay insurance less. Insurance, tax which I'm to pay, because whatever depreciation 1 lakh went, my car was 5 lakh, now it is 4 lakh. Where is 1 lakh gone? I lost it. So when I lost it, that is my expenditure. So my income has gone down. I'm going to tell the government that my income has gone down. I'm not going to pay that much of tax now. So depreciation is calculated to basically adjust the insurance cost, reduce the income tax which you have to pay, something like that, right? It is not a resale value. Don't think it is a resale value. Now, there are some methods. Method which I'm giving you, just take these notes from the website and you need not to write it here. What are the methods? Straight line method, declining balance method, double declining balance method, sum of years, digits, unit of production. These are some of the methods. Now, this depreciation was one of the topic in engineering services. We used to do that time. For preliminary, those of you who are writing preliminary, depreciation is a topic for you in the engineering services preliminary. But for others, just know the names. Okay, let's go for next. That is now question number 19. And there comes a question for you. Cycle counting in inventory. Cycle counting in inventory is what is inventory, you know what is the meaning of inventory, you know, stockpile, whatever you keep. What is the meaning of cycle counting in that? Let me give you four choices. What is the cycle counting in that? This provides the measure of inventory turnover. So how much is the inventory turnover? Measure of that is cycle counting. It means inventory records are periodically verified. Inventory records are periodically verified. See, provides annual details. Then this is inventory prediction method. You know, many question in exam will come where you will feel that, okay, I don't know anything about this. How shall I hit it now? there you can make a difference. Just think again, read the choices carefully. You will get some kind of clue. Okay, it is matching, looking like similar. Cycle counting, cycle. Cycle is a term which is basically related to periodicity. And believe me, these things work in the exam. These things work in the exam. 4 to 5 questions which decide your fate are to be solved on the basis of these thumb rules. Like eliminating, using the dimensional or unit analysis, dimensional analysis, and then common sense, something like this. Cycle and periodicity looks like same kind of concepts, right? So use these things and it works. So answer for this is B. Answer for this is B. Cycle counting is inventory records are verified periodically. That is the meaning of it, right? As I told you, you are not supposed to write it. You need not to write it. Just solve these questions. Now I go to next question. Question number 20. If total cycle time is 10 minutes, and out of which 5 minutes used for arc welding and 4 minutes is dwell time. Dwell means I am waiting, I am not welding. Find the duty cycle in percentage as per American Society of Mechanical Engineers standardization. SME standardization. So answer is 55%, 50%, 45%, 40%. So what happened is you gave me 10 minutes. In the 10 minutes, I'm welding for 5 minutes and I'm waiting for 4 minutes. Dwelling time, I'm giving rest or something. So what happens? What is the duty cycle? How do you define the duty cycle? Okay. Now let me tell you what is American Society of Mechanical Engineers. First of all, answer to this question is 50%. Now, American Society of Mechanical Engineers may guidelines is, if you want to find out duty cycle of heavy machine like arc welding machine, then you need to take a cycle time of 10 minutes. It is not that 1 hour may 50% duty cycle means continuously I am welding for half an hour. Then it is not 50%, because duty cycle may very important cycle is to be defined, and that cycle is of 10 minutes. Now 50% duty cycle means in 10 minutes, if you are to weld for 5 minutes and then compulsorily give break to your machine, otherwise it will get overloading or overheating. So you don't want that. 10 minutes may 5 minutes work, rest you have to stop. So that is a 50% duty cycle. So how do you define it? Arc time over cycle time. Cycle time into 100. What is arc time? 5 minutes. What is cycle time? 10 minutes. So what is the duty cycle? 50%. But do not think if duty cycle is 50%, in 1 hour, how much I am welding. Don't say this is continuously 30 minutes. It is not continuously 30 minutes. In 10 minutes, you have to stop, only work for 5 minutes. That's the meaning of it. Okay, let me go for next question. There comes question number 21. Now, job number, you are given job number, and then you have, binding. You have binding and then you have cutting machine and binding machine. This is what is given. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So this is 8. Job number 1, binding machine takes 8 minute and cutting machine takes again 8 minute. Job number 2, 7, 6. Job number 3, 7, 2. Then 6, 5. Then 4, 7. This is the data given. You have to sequence the jobs such that you get optimum total span. You have to sequence the jobs so that total span time is minimum. total span time is minimum. Understand what is the question? Every job is to go for two operations. One is binding, another is cutting. When I take job one on binding machine, 8 minutes takes, and cutting machine may 8 minutes take. When I take job two on binding machine, 7 minutes take, and then cutting may 6 minutes take. Now tell me, which job should I take to the first machine? Which job should I take to the first machine? And then second job, which I should take to the second machine, first machine, so that minimum total time is reduced. In this question, there is one small issue. And the issue is, you know, cutting comes first and then binding comes. That is a fixed order. So this is machine one and this is machine two. In the data, he has given machine two at the top. But actual may, first you have to take job to machine one, cutting and then binding, right or not? Cutting and then grinding comes. You cannot bind and then cut it, right? So first comes your cutting and then comes binding. So what you have to do is, you have to put machine number two below machine number one. So how it is this? 8, 7, 7, 6, 4. This is how it is to be there. So first cutting, let me see whether it is correct. 8, 6, 2, 5, 7. Yes, 8, 7, 7, 6, 4. Now, so this machine M2 will come after M1. Now, how sequencing is done? Johnson algorithm is used. You use the Johnson algorithm for sequencing. What you do? Just see where is the minimum. Where is the minimum number coming? Which number is coming minimum? And if the minimum number is coming on machine first, you have to sequence it first. So first my machine will be 3. This machine, sorry, job number 3 will come the first. So job 3 will come first. If minimum number time is on machine 1, I am to sequence it first. And then I am removing now this job number 3 is removed. It is no more to be used. Okay. Now go next. Next minimum number is 4, but it is on machine 2. If it is on machine 2, that means job number 5 is to be sequenced at the last. If the minimum time is on machine 2, it is to be sequenced last. Johnson's algorithm. This also goes. Now what is left? 5. 5 is on machine 1. That means job 4 is fighting for early. Initial stop. Job 4. This is also going. Now comes 6. 6 also job 2. And then what is left is job 1. So what is the sequence? Sequence is job 3 will come first. Then job 4 will come. Job 2 will come. Job 1 will come. Job 5 will come. That is the sequence of the machines which we are to follow. I hope you understood this. This is the sequence of the machines which we are to follow. Okay. Done. Now let's go for next question. Question number now 22. I come to question number 22. I'm giving you the task. I'm giving you the predecessor activities, and I'm giving you the time taken of each activity. There are tasks A, B, C, D, E, F, and there is no predecessor activity of A and B. C and D have predecessor as A, E has B and C, F has D and E. These are the predecessor activities. And what is the time taken? 16. 20, then 8, then 10, then 6, then 12. And the question is, find the critical time of completion of this entire project. Critical time. So these are the 6 tasks in a particular, you know, project, and predecessor activities. A ke before there is no activity, B before there is no activity, but before C and D, A should be completed. So what is the time taken in each activity? That is also given. You know what is to be done. You have to make a, you know, network diagram, and then you are to solve that network diagram and tell what is the critical time. Let me give you the answer choices. Choice A is 36, 40, 42, 44. So what is the critical time for completion of this? Tell me what is the critical time of completion of this. So what is the critical time of completion of this? As I told you, that exam may question may be little, it may take more than 1 minute. You have 1 minute, one question. It may take more than 1 minute. So this is the network diagram. There is no predecessor of A and B, but before C and D, A should be completed. Before E, C and B should be complete. Before F, D and E should be complete. This is the network diagram. Now, when I make the earliest start time and latest finish time, then what I get here is, this is what I get. So 24 24, and this I get 42 42. So the critical time in which I can complete this entire task is 42. Many of you are finding it now difficult to pace up. 1 minute, one question, you need to get 30 out of 40. This is 22nd question. You need to find 30 questions correct out of 40 when you can say your preparation level is good and within the time period. So 16 minute, when I hit 3, either it is 20 or it is 24, I take the larger one. 24 24 6 30 16 10 26, I take the larger one. Then 42 days will be required to complete entire project. So that is the task for us. Okay, let me go for question number 23. See this question now. Which of the following symbols, is used for inspection, in industries? So you know, industries mein there are so many symbols used. So which one do you use for inspection? Okay, A, B, C, D. Which symbol is used for inspection in the industry? Which symbol will you use for inspection in the industry? Hit the answer. Many of you now have become silent. What answer will you give? Which symbol will you use for inspection? A, B, C, D. Hit the right answer. You know, in the industry, there are symbols for everything. Inspection, transportation, observation, operation, storage, danger sign. Yes. So O is used for operation. D is used for delay. This is used for storage. This is used for transportation. And this is used for inspection. So inspection is rectangular. So D is the answer for this. You use inspection ke liye. This particular is used for inspection. Okay, this is used for inspection. Right? This is how we go for it. Let me hit next question. 24th question. Don't lose motivation. Keep solving. 24th question. Mass of 1 kg is attached. Mass of 1 kg is attached to the spring. There is a stiffness 0.7 Newton per millimeter. Critical damping coefficient. Will be 1.4 Newton second per meter. Very simple question. 52.9, same unit. 18.52, 529.2. So there is a mass of 1 kg which is attached to a spring of stiffness 0.7 Newton per millimeter. You have to find out what is the critical damping coefficient of this. You should know what is critical damping coefficient. A, B, C, D. Just solve and tell me what is the answer for this. What is the critical damping coefficient? Okay, what is the answer for this? What is the critical damping coefficient? Critical damping coefficient is 2 root of Km. What is K? K is nothing but 0.7 into 1000. That is the Newton per meter, you know, stiffness. What is M? M is 1. So what is C critical? 2 into 700 under root. If you solve it, you get 52.9. Right? So thumb rule you can use. It cannot be 1.4, it cannot be 18, it cannot be 529. You need not to calculate exactly. Don't start calculating exactly. I'm giving you another thumb rule to solve the questions fast. If you see the under root of this, you need not to calculate. Answer choices cannot be 1.4, cannot be 18. You square 18, you get it. It is not that value. So try to solve it that way, right? Moreover, what you can do is, you know, 25 into 25, 625. Under root of 625 is 25. 25 into 2 is 50. It is little more than 50, right? But it cannot be more than 60 because 30 into 30, 900. So 25 to 30, right? 25 to 30, and then you multiply. You need to pace up fast. You have to solve. Next question is now question number 25. Question number 25. Equation of free vibration. Equation of free vibration. Equation of free vibration is given as x double dot plus 36 pi square x is equal to 0. Natural frequency is choice A 6 hertz, choice B 3 hertz, choice C 3 pi hertz, choice D 6 pi hertz. So this is the question given to you, and I'm very sure you will solve it fast now. Equation of free vibration is given as this. You have to find out what is the natural frequency of vibration. So not only knowing is important, but you know, fast solving and correctly solving is the another challenge in the exams. So you should solve fast and accurately. Compare it with omega n square x is equal to 0. Omega n comes out to be 36 pi square under root, comes out to be 6 pi. But you know what? We are finding it in the form of hertz. So f omega n is 2 pi f, it comes out to be 3 hertz. So answer for that is 3 hertz. Very simple question. Hardly there was anything in this. Very, very simple question here. Right? Okay. So what you are doing is you are solving the Cochin Shipyard paper. 40 questions. My target is 30. If you get 30, you can say, okay, my level is good. Now let me take you to the next question. 26th question. Sensitivity of isochronous governor is 0, then 1, then 2, infinity. How do you define the sensitivity and what is isochronous governor? What do you mean by isochronous governor and what do you understand by sensitivity? Yes, hit the answer. What is the sensitivity of isochronous governor? That is a question. So what do you mean by sensitivity and what do you mean by isochronous governor? Right? Now, sensitivity is nothing but mean speed over range of speed. Mean speed over range of speed. That is the sensitivity. If range of speed becomes zero, minimum to maximum, then sensitivity becomes maximum. Now, what happens in isochronous governor is that speed remains constant. Equilibrium speed is constant for all radii of rotation of the ball. As you know, the ball will be rotating at particular radial distance. Isochronous, iso means same. Even if ball moves away, then you know the rotation, radius ke saath rotation is not changing. Rotational speed remains same with the radius, right? Even if there is a small change in radius. And if that is the case, speed range of the speed becomes zero. If range of speed becomes zero, it is highly sensitive. That simply means that even if there's a small change in the speed, it will be thrown out to a great distance. Radial will be thrown out to a great distance. That is the meaning of it. So its a sensitivity is infinite. Isochronous governor has infinite sensitivity. Question number 27. Let's see whether you hit it. Automobile gearbox has choice A, simple gear train, choice B, epicyclic gear train, choice C, compound gear train, choice D, compound epicyclic gear train. Compound epicyclic gear train. So these are the four choices given to us. Simple gear train, epicyclic gear train, compound gear train, or compound epicyclic gear train. Automobile gearbox. Okay, the answer for this is compound gear train. You know what is the meaning of compound gear train? The gear which are mounted on the, you know, same shaft. They're called compound gear, which are mounted on the same shaft. So this is how it goes, right? So this one side, input gear, and then there's a compound gear, and then further there is a, you know, there can be compound gear and output. So these are called compound gear. The gears which are mounted on the same shaft. So this is the driver, this side. And these two are compound gear train. These are the compound gear. And this is the driven gear. This is a driver gear. This is a driven gear. And in between there are two compound gear. So automobile gearbox has basically compound gear train. That is the meaning of it. Compound gear train. So this is the information, you know, more or less related to information, which you should know what is the application of particular gear train. Compound gear train. What is a compound gear train? More than one gears on the same shaft. Next question is also data oriented question. Question number 28. Clutch used in trucks is choice A, centrifugal clutch, B, cone clutch, C, multi-plate clutch, D, single plate clutch. Okay, go for it. Tell me what is the answer. You know, you will expect these kind of information related questions in the exam, where questions are directly related to the data or information. So which clutch is used in the trucks? What kind of clutch do you use in the trucks? That is a question. What clutch do you use in the trucks? Answer for that is clutch used is single plate clutch. Answer for that is D. So, you know, there is no negative marking in your exam. So don't leave question unattempted. Just attempt all the question. Don't leave it unattempted. So let me create the space here. So yeah, let's go for question number 29. I go to question number 29. Strain energy. This is the question. Strain energy in a beam subjected to the bending moment M is EI is given as flexural rigidity. It is flexural rigidity. Choices are m square over 2EI into dx integration, then m square over 4EI dx integration, then m square over EI dx integration, and 2m square over EI dx integration. Everybody can solve this. Very simple. M square over EI dx integration. What do you think is the strain energy in the beam? Same formula is there for strain energy when a body bar is subjected to axial loading, beam is subjected to bending, or shaft is subjected to torque or torsion loading. So same formula is there for that also. So strain energy stored, formula for this is m square over 2EI dx, m square over 2EI into dx. That is a question number 29. You need not to write anything. All these 40 questions are available, and I have taken these questions which I think are very, very important for any exam. I've taken from there. And when you do these questions, forward backward linkages, okay, if I'm to do this formula, I'm to do the formula of torsion also and axial loading also. That way you revise it. And before your coaching exam, which I think will be in the second week of your December, we'll do more such questions. Okay, let's go for next question now. Question number 30. He has given you this shaft. He has given you this, cantilever. Loading is done at A. So this length is 2L by 3, and this is L by 3. This is a single point load applied at point A, and the length is 2L by 3. What is the deflection at free end? Question is deflection at free end. What is the deflection at free end? Answer choices given are 2PL³/81EI. The next question is 3PL³/81EI. The next is 14PL³/81EI. And last is 15PL³/81EI. Deflection. So if you know the method to solve it, it can be easily done. Solve it and tell me what is the answer for this. Okay, now see what happens is this. We have the formula. If this is L, this is P. What is the deflection produced and what is the slope? We have the formula, right? If the load is applied at the free end, we know what is the formula of deflection and the slope both. So instead of L, I'm going to use 2L by 3, right or not? So if I use 2L by 3, I get to know the deflection at A, but I don't want to find deflection at A. So deflection at B is deflection at A plus something. And the moment this particular beam is, you know, loaded at P, this is a straight line. Beyond A to B, it is a straight line. So deflection at A plus this value is deflection at B. And how much is this value? This is slope into L by 3. So L by 3 into slope produced at A. Slope at A and slope at B are equal. You remember the formula, what is the slope and deflection at the free end? If point load is applied, you need to remember that formula. And now deflection at B is deflection at A. That you can calculate by putting 2L by 3 here, plus L by 3 into slope. You know the formula. So if you do that, you calculate the value. Let me give you P into 2L by 3 cube by 3EI. What is the formula of deflection? PL cube over 3EI. That is the formula of deflection. But instead of L, I am putting 2L by 3. Now, plus L by 3 into slope. Now, what is the formula of slope? Slope is P into 2L by 3 whole square over 2EI. over 2EI. So what is the formula of slope? Slope is PL square over 2EI. So if you remember the formula of deflection and slope, then you can use this concept. So the moment you solve it, answer is coming out to be 14 PL cube over 81 EI. Yes. So many of you have calculated it. It is an easy question to be solved. 14 PL cube over 81 EI. Okay, done. Let's go to next question. That is 31. Question number 31. Air with initial conditions. Air with initial conditions of pressure and volume P1V1 expands to P1/2 3V1. The process is I say hyperbolic. Second, adiabatic. C, polytropic with n is greater than 1. D, polytropic with n less than 1. Okay, so what is the question? Is P1V1 is changing into P1/2 into and 3V1. So initial condition is P1V1 and now it goes to P1/2 3V1. You have to tell what kind of process is this. If it is a polytropic process, what is the adiabatic in, what is the polytropic index? That is the question. That is the question. Right? Now, we know P1 V1 raised to power n is P2 V2 raised to power n. Log of P1 plus n log of V1 is equal to log of P2 plus n log of V2. I want to find out n. That gives me n is nothing but log of P2/P1. P2/P1 over log of V1/V2. That's it. Very simple. Polytropic process means P1 V1 raised to n is equal to P2 V2 raised to n. And you know the relation between P1 V1 is polytropic only. Relation is always polytropic. So if you put the values, n comes out to be 0.63. So answer for this is D. That is the answer for this. D is the answer for this. N is 0.63. I'm sure you people are getting the answers. Right? Let's go to question number 32. And you people are solving the full length paper with me. Difficulty level of Cochin Shipyard. And we have to solve 30 out of 40. Then we'll say, okay, our level is good, but no mistakes, no guesswork, 30 correct, right? Reversible heat engine. This is the question. There is a reversible heat engine, which is undergoing cyclic process. It is undergoing cyclic process, receiving heat, and it is receiving heat from source at 727 degrees centigrade and rejecting to sink at 27 degrees centigrade. Very simple. There is a reversible heat engine which is working between source and sink. So source is at 727 degrees centigrade and sink is at 27 degrees centigrade. There is a source and there is a sink, right? There is a source and there is a sink. Right? And now, assuming heat transfer takes place isothermally, assuming heat transfer takes place isothermally, assuming that heat transfer takes place isothermally, rate of heat rejection in kilowatt per kilowatt of work output, per kilowatt of work output is, answer choices are 0.04, then 0.43, then 1.04, 1.43. Just hit the answer. So there is a reversible heat engine which is undergoing cyclic process, receiving heat from source, rejecting heat to the sink. Assuming heat transfer takes place isothermally, rate of heat rejection in kilowatt per kilowatt of work output. What do you think is the answer? What is the answer for this? You are solving the paper for Cochin Shipyard, 40 questions, and you are to get more than 30 in this. Okay, let me make the diagram here. You know how efficiency is calculated? This is work output, this is heat supplied, heat rejected. This is T1, this is T2. Maximum efficiency is 1 minus T2 by T1, which is basically T1, T2 are to be put in terms of Kelvin. So this comes out to be 7 by 10. T2 is 27 degree centigrade, 300 Kelvin. T1 is, 727 degree centigrade, 1000 Kelvin. So maximum efficiency is 7 by 10. Now, efficiency is also, because it is a reversible heat engine, its actual efficiency is W by Q1, right? And he is giving you per kilowatt of work output. So work output W is 1 kilowatt, right? So if this is 1 kilowatt, he is asking you what is Q2 by W kitna hoga? That is a question he is asking you. So if you see, question is what is Q2 by W, right? Now this is efficiency 7 by 10. So 1 by Q1 is equal to 7 by 10. And what is Q2? Q2 is Q1 minus W. Q2 is Q1 by W. So Q1 comes out to be, how much is Q1? 10 by 7. Q1 is 10 by 7. And W is 1. W is 1. So then Q2 is nothing but 3 by 7, and that comes out to be 0.43 kilowatt. So that is the answer which we are going to get for this particular question. So the answer for this is per kilowatt of W is there. So the concept was efficiency can be calculated by two ways, work over heat input and through temperature. So reversible ke liye this is the formula, but because reversible was given, both the efficiencies are equal. So Q1 I can calculate and Q2 can also be calculated. So next question is really very good question. Try to solve this question if you can solve. Try to solve this question. It is a really good question. Let me give you this question. Now this is 1, 2, 3. This is a cycle which is given to us. Let's say temperature here is T high. This is T now C. This is T intermediate. And this is TS diagram. TS diagram mein this is the cycle given as a triangle to us. It's a good question. This one is a good question. You have to find the ratio of engine efficiency. Ratio of engine efficiency to the Carnot efficiency is what? Now this is the engine working on a cycle. And the cycle is 1, 2, 3 cycle. Right? This is TH, this is TC, this is TI. So TS diagram is given. And you have to find out the ratio of efficiency of the engine for which cycle is given to the Carnot cycle. And the answer choices are this. TH minus TC over TH plus TI. Second choice is TH minus TC over TH plus TC. Third is TH over TH plus TI. And D choice is TI over TH plus TI. So these are the four choices given to us. There are three temperatures given to us. There are three temperatures which are given to us. TH, TC, TI. TI corresponds to 3, TC corresponds to 1, TH corresponds to 2. That is how it is given. Now let me give you the concept here. The efficiency of actual engine is nothing but net work output over heat input. This is the formula which we know. Efficiency of actual engine is net work output over heat input. Efficiency of Carnot cycle is nothing but 1 minus minimum temperature over maximum temperature of the cycle. Minimum temperature of the cycle is TC, maximum temperature of the cycle is TH. So this is the Carnot cycle efficiency as we understand. Done. Now how to calculate W net? W net is nothing but this entire area of the, you know, cycle on TS diagram. Area of the cycle on TS diagram gives me W net. Can you find out this area? This is W net. Yes. And what is the heat input? If this is the cycle given to you on TS diagram, then entire area under this heat input part, this entire area is Q input. You need to know that. This is the reason I'm saying this is a good question. This area is W net, net work done is a cycle, net W or net heat, whatever you call it. And can you tell me which process is heat addition process? 2 to 3 is heat addition process. 3 to 1 is heat rejection process. But I'm only concentrating, I'm only talking about heat input Q1. Heat rejector nahi. And there's no heat interaction from 1 to 2, that is isentropic process. Now, these two areas, if I know, I calculate the efficiency of engine. Now, let's see how to calculate it. How to calculate this area? This area is half of base. What is base? This is base. This base is TH minus TC. Triangle area is half of base into height. And what is the height? Height is now, let's assume this is S3, this is S1. S3 minus S1. Entropy corresponding to 3 minus entropy corresponding to 1. So what is this area is? Half of TH minus TC, this base into this height, S3 minus S1, that is W net. And how to find out this? Now, if I want to find out this area, let me give you this diagram. Let me make this diagram once again. Have we found out this area now? Yes, this is W net. And what is this area? Half of TH minus TC, TH minus TC into S3 minus S1. This is 3, this is 1, this is 2. So this is S3, this is S1. Okay, done. Now I want to find out this entire area. This area I've already calculated. If you calculate this as TC, this is S3 minus S1. So what is this area? Sir, this is TC into S3 minus S1. Agree? Rectangle. And how much is this area? So this area is now half of base, which is S3 minus S1 into height. What is height? TI minus TC. What is this temperature? TI. So what is this height now? This is TI minus TC. Half of height into base. Now what is the total Q in? Q input is this half of TH minus TC into S3 minus S1 plus TC into S3 minus S1 plus half of S3 minus S1 into TI minus TC, right? So S3 minus S1 is coming common here also and here also. So the moment you add and you calculate the engine efficiency, it is W net over Q input. So you understand, half and this will get cancelled out. Half and this will get cancelled out from everywhere except yahan pe 2 multiply ho jayega. To kitna gaya? TH minus TC plus 2 TC plus TI minus TC. Ab usme ek cheez dekho, TC cancel ho jayega and this will remain as TH minus TI. This will remain TH minus TI. So what will be the answer? This will be equal to TH minus TC over TH minus TI. This is the efficiency of the engine. TH minus TC over TH minus TI is the efficiency of the engine. But the question was ratio of, this is how much? This is TH minus T. What is the value? TH minus TC TC over TH minus TI. And what is this? TH minus TC over TH. अब इन दोनों का रेशियो ले लोगे तो दिस इज द आंसर. एज आई टोल्ड यू दिस क्वेश्चन इज गुड. दिस क्वेश्चन वॉज गुड. सो इन योर एग्जाम यू विल कम अक्रॉस वन और टू क्वेश्चन विच विल बी वेरी वेरी लॉन्ग क्वेश्चन. यू शुड नॉट इवन अटेम्प्ट. इफ यू डोंट हैव टाइम यू शुड नॉट अटेम्प्ट. दैट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ इट. राइट. दिस इज हाउ इट इज टू बी डन. ओके. सो दिस वॉज द क्वेश्चन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ दिस. Okay, let me go for question number 34 now. Question number 34. A large furnace can supply heat at temperature at 1200 Kelvin at steady rate of 3200 kilowatt. Ambient temperature is 27 degree centigrade. Availability of this energy is 0 kilowatt, 800 kilowatt, 1200 kilowatt, 2400 kilowatt. This question is related to availability. Large furnace can supply heat at steady rate of this. Ambient temperature is this. Availability of this energy is what? The question is availability. So what is the question is, there is a furnace at 1200 Kelvin and it is giving you heat energy of 3200 kilowatt. You have to find out what is the availability of this energy. What is the availability in this energy? So available energy or availability is Q1 minus unavailable energy. Remember that. Whenever you have to calculate available energy or availability, that is the same thing. Available energy and availability is the same thing. So whenever you have to calculate available energy or availability, that is nothing but Q1 minus unavailable energy. This is Q1. Unavailable energy, on the other hand, is ambient temperature into delta S. And what is delta S? Delta S is Q into Q over T naught. Right? So what is delta S? Heat entropy change associated with heat flow. So that is, now what? Sorry, T1. Entropy change associated with this temperature is T1, Q by T1. So what is Q1 minus T naught into Q by T1? I take Q1 common, 1 minus T naught by T1. What is this? 3200 into 1 minus what is T naught? T naught is 300 and what is this? 1200. Right? So this will come out to be 2400 kilowatt. Answer is 2400 kilowatt. That is the answer for this. Availability questions are very simple. They are not difficult. Available energy or availability, they are the simple questions. But you should know how to calculate unavailable energy. Okay, let's go for question number 35. Pump raises pressure of saturated liquid water at 100 kilopascal. Density is given as 959 kilogram per meter cube to 2 megapascal. So the question is, there is a pump which is raising the pressure of saturated liquid water from 100 kilopascal to 2 megapascal, and density of the water liquid is also given. Isentropic efficiency isentropic efficiency of pump is 0.92. Work done by the pump is, answer choices are 2.2 kilojoule per kg, then 1.4, 2.6, 3.1. So these are the basically choices, answer choices provided to us. So what is the work done by the pump? Okay, try to solve this. What is the answer for this? So pump raises the pressure from this to this. Isentropic efficiency is given. Work done by pump is how much? Can you tell me what is the actual work done? You know, isentropic work done is VDP or DP by rho. DP is nothing but 2 megapascal, let us say 2000 kilopascal minus 100 kilopascal over 959. This is the work which is to be done, VDP, isentropic work, VDP work. VDP work by pump is V specific volume, 1 by density. DP, how much is the pressure raised? 100 kilopascal to 2000 kilopascal. 2 megapascal is 2000 kilopascal. So that is the work which pump is to do, isentropic. What is actual work? Actual work I am to do is basically has to be more than isentropic work. Isentropic work is the minimum work, then efficiency I am to divide, and actual work is always more than isentropic work. In case of turbine, you get less output, less actual work than isentropic work. In case of pump, you need to do more actual work than isentropic work. If the work done is isentropic, I need to do less work. That is this, right? But because it is the actual work which I am to do, I am to divide by efficiency, not multiply by efficiency. That comes out to be then 2.2 kilojoule per kg. That is answer for this. That brings me to question number 36. Now, type of wall. One side he has given you type of wall, another side temperature distribution. Another side is temperature distribution. So what are the wall he has given you? Plain wall, then cylindrical wall, and then spherical wall. And on another side, logarithmic, then hyperbolic, then parabolic, then straight line, and then exponential. Exponential. So what is given is, there is a type of walls, plane wall, cylindrical wall, spherical wall. On the other side, it is a temperature distribution. And he has given you answer choices also. Answer choices are for PQR 413, 453, 512, 412. Hit the answer. What do you think is the answer for this? So hit, what is the answer for this? What do you think is the answer for this? Okay, answer is D. Plane wall has linear. So I'll go for plane wall, linear temperature distribution. Cylindrical wall has logarithmic temperature distribution. Now this is more or less heat transfer. May you need to basically understand these particular concepts. Spherical is hyperbolic. Spherical is hyperbolic. So that was the temperature distribution as per the wall. We come to question number 37. Question number 37. At critical point, at critical point of water, at critical point of water, value of Prandtl number, value of Prandtl number will be, choices given are 0, 1, infinity, insufficient data. So critical point is something which you have to understand. At critical point of water, what will be the value of Prandtl number? Do you have any formula for this to calculate Prandtl number? So what is Prandtl number is mu Cp over K. You know this formula. So this is the formula of Prandtl number. You know the Prandtl number. Now at critical temperature for water, at critical temperature for water, you know Cp is not defined. And hence, for Prandtl number also, it comes out to be infinite or not defined. At critical point, critical temperature, Cp is not defined, infinite. You have done that in heat transfer, and hence what you get is this value also not defined. Next question, 38 question. It's a good question. This is a horizontal pipe, and then there's a U-tube manometer, and then there's a inverted U-tube manometer. There's a U-tube manometer and there's a inverted U-tube manometer. This point is A, this point is B. There's a difference in level. There's a difference in level of these two. This is X. This one is Y. Limb difference is X and Y. Specific gravity 0.8, specific gravity 13.6, and water is flowing. You have to find the ratio of Y over X. Answer choices given are 10, 43, 63, 83. You have to find the ratio of Y and X. There is a U-tube manometer in which there is a mercury, and there is an inverted U-tube manometer at the same two positions in a horizontal pipe. You have to find the ratio of Y and X. You have to find the ratio of Y and X. So what will be ratio of Y and X? How to solve it? How do you think it is to be solved? Now see, inverted U-tube manometer is used when pressure difference is very small and you want to see that clearly. Y is always more than X. Now, if I use the manometric equation at these two levels, you know, I will get PA minus PB is equal to rho mercury minus rho water into G into X. That is the equation you will get it. If you put PA plus rho G H, rho of water, PB plus rho water G into this plus rho mercury into G into this height, if you do, you will get this equation. Similarly, if I equate the pressure at these two points, use the equation, it will be rho water minus rho oil into G into Y. Same pressure difference. Now, G gets cancelled out. What is rho mercury? Rho mercury is 13,600 kilogram per meter cube. Rho of oil is 800 kilogram per meter cube. Rho of water is 1000 kilogram per meter cube. These three densities we know. Specific gravities are given. So if you put it in this, Y is coming out to be 63 times X. Y will come out to be 63 times X. Indeed, it was a good question. This was a good question. Now we hit last two question. Question number 39. Find capillary rise
of pure water, of pure water in the capillary tube of dia 2 millimeter at room temperature. Let's say at room temperature. Answer choices given are 5 millimeter, 10 millimeter, 15 millimeter, 20 millimeter. Find the capillary rise in the capillary tube of dia 2 millimeter at room temperature. What will be rise? Now, you know, we have formula of water height level. How much is the h? 4 sigma cos theta over rho into g into d. That is the formula we know. Rise of capillary. That is the formula we have. Now, this sigma surface tension we don't know. 0.073 Newton per meter is the surface tension of water at room temperature. You need to memorize it. Sometimes, you know, you need to memorize the data. So, sigma surface tension is 0.073 Newton per meter is the surface tension of water. Please memorize it. Like specific gravity density, you need to memorize it. For pure water, theta angle of contact is 0 degree. Cos 0 is 1. The rest is known. Other terms are known to you. Only surface tension of the water you need to memorize. And this comes out to be 15 millimeter if you put all the values. If you put all the values, this comes out to be 15 millimeter. Let's go for the last question. Specific weight of 1 liter. Specific weight of 1 liter of petrol of specific gravity. Of specific gravity 0.7 is. These are the answer. 700 Newton per meter cube, 6867 Newton per meter cube, 9810 Newton per meter cube, 6.8 Newton per meter cube. Very simple question, last question, and a very simple question. Specific weight of 1 liter of petrol of specific gravity, this. Any idea what is specific weight? It is weight per unit volume. What is weight? Mg per unit volume. Mass per unit volume is nothing but rho g. Specific weight is nothing but rho g. And any idea what is the unit of this? Because it is weight per unit volume, it is Newton per meter cube. Weight ka unit is Newton, volume ka unit is meter cube. Now, what is the rho? Rho is 700 kilogram per meter cube. Why? Because specific gravity multiplied by density of water. If you multiply these two, this is the answer you are going to get. 6867 Newton per meter cube is the answer for that. Okay, so that brings us to an end of this session. That is Cochin Shipyard 40 question session. You know, you need, if you are preparing well, you need to understand where your level is. Out of 40, if you are hitting 30, your level is good. We will keep on going for such more sessions. We'll keep on doing such more sessions. If you are hitting 30 out of 40, your level is okay. Just give your best. Exam of Cochin might come second week of December. So those of you who are preparing for this exam, fill this form. Please prepare really well. This entire document you can download from our website of UOPD Education, and description of that is attached to the video. You can take from there. All the very best, and thanks for being with me in this particular class. Thank you.